So, let's see. Was everybody trying, able to get onto the website and download?
I couldn't find the website.
Okay. I will email you that link. You can find it in a couple of different ways. One is on the department's website. On the department's website, there should be a link there. If it's not there, I'll make sure that it's not there. Okay. But I did email it to everyone who was registered for class, but you might not be registered at the time of that, so I'll follow up on that. But if you got to the website, were you able to download the materials?
Yes.
All right, so the problem session is currently scheduled on Fridays from 10 to 11 in room 190. We may start at from 10:15, depending on when the chair seminar gets out and when Greg Taylor kicks us out for the ASHCO seminar that takes place at, he starts at 11:30, so we'll have some room in there in between. During that, we'll then have a chance to talk about the problem set or whatever else you want to discuss. And we'll schedule some additional time with our TAs for the week coming. We need to think about the room, and so we'll set that. All right? Yes, sir.
For clarity's sake, is that AM or PM?
That is AM. I'm a night owl, but not that. All right. So the last time we were just introducing the subject, and what we were talking about was this idea of coherence, and coherence is our the star of our show in the subject of quantum optics. And what we discuss is coherence, the way to think about what coherence is the capacity of a system to exhibit interference. Okay? Now, interference comes in different flavors. We're familiar with interference in the context of classical physics, in that waves interfere. And in particular, light is a wave and will exhibit interference if the light is coherent. And that interference is arising from alternate paths in physical space that the waves can take that lead to the same final event, detection, say, of the light on a screen. Okay, so there are two alternative paths here in physical space. And that, it could be multiple paths, it doesn't have to be two. Obviously, there are many paths that interfere. Quantum interference, we think about this as not an interference of waves, being waves meaning the physical excitation of a field, like the amplitude of water above the surface, or even something as abstract as the amplitude of an electric or magnetic field, but something more abstract. What is interfering is alternative histories or processes which could have occurred that lead to the same final event. So in this case, the history is related to the trajectory, if you like, of the quantum of light, the photon, that could have led to detection here. And there are alternative histories here sketched. The photon might have gone this way, it might have gone that way, and those two possible histories are, there is associated with them a probability amplitude, and to each one of them, we assign a particular amplitude, and the total amplitude is the sum of those amplitudes, and of course, then we get interference because of those cross terms. Okay. Now, one of the lessons that we take away from this picture is that in this case, we can understand the classical wave interference, or at least not understand, but there is a complete one-to-one mapping of the classical wave interference with the quantum interference associated with the history of single particles. Okay? So this interference effect is kind of a single particle effect. Each photon, photon by photon, is described by a wave amplitude that is essentially, up to some normalization, the complex amplitude of the electric field. And the square of that amplitude tells me the probability of the photon landing on the screen somewhere. But of course, if I collect many copies, then ultimately I will see the expected value, which is related to this electric field, as we'll see. And as we discussed last time, this is the famous statement by Dirac that led to a tremendous amount of confusion and eventually led to the birth of modern quantum optics, that the way to think about the quantum mechanics is that no photons are interfering with one another, that what happens is a single photon interferes with itself. Okay? And the statement is that the way to consistently understand these two pictures is to think about it photon by photon. So in this particular case, this kind of interference phenomena, there's really not that big of a difference between thinking about the quantum interference from classical interference. This is effectively classical in some sense. We'll get it. I mean, these terms, this is classical, this is non-classical, these are the kinds of, you know, arguments about dancing on the head of the pin that quantum opticians love to have. There's reason to try to finally sort out what we mean by what is classical, what is non-classical, because one of the things we've come to understand is if we can harness aspects of physical systems that are not and cannot be described by the classical laws of physics, then that's powerful. We might be able to harness those physical systems and their quantum behavior to do things that physical systems that obey the classical laws of physics just can't do. So making that distinction is important because it gives us kind of goalposts. Okay, but in this case, what we see is there's a one-to-one correspondence. The histories that I'm talking about here in this are nothing more than the paths in physical space that the waves travel. Okay, so giving the fancy name history or process is a kind of, you know, it's the path the photon takes, which is the same as the path the wave takes. However, there are more general cases, and one of the things we talked about at the very end of lecture last time is this case of what's known as the Hung-O-Mandel interference. And it's the following experiment. We have a nonlinear crystal, and that nonlinear crystal has the property that it causes the spontaneous decay of a big fat UV photon into two infrared photons that are twins. So this will call this omega IR omega IR and omega UV, and it's such that the sum of these energies, H bar omega IR times 2, is equal to H bar omega UV. The UV energy is twice as big, okay? But these photons are twin photons, and they're indistinguishable. They're the same, and they're born essentially at exactly the same time. It's femtoseconds. And what we saw is that there are possible histories that can lead to detection. We take these two photons, we bounce them from mirrors, and recombine them on a beam splitter. Then there are possible processes. I mean, I've drawn two of them here. There's another process, which is this guy gets reflected, this guy gets transmitted. There's another one where this guy gets transmitted and this guy gets reflected. And each one of those four processes lead to different detection events. Well, at least three of them are different. This one leads to the detection event where both photons are clicked here and none are clicked there. This process or history corresponds to both detected here and none here. But these two are indistinguishable to the degree that these photons are indistinguishable. And because of that, we have the Feynman rule. The Feynman rule tells us that to find out the probability of a certain event occurring, we must add not the probabilities of different processes that lead to the same final event, but add the probability amplitudes that correspond, that are indistinguishable, that lead to that same final event. And to the degree to which those two photons are indistinguishable, there's no way in principle to tell which of those processes happened that would lead to the case where I would get one click here and one click there. And thus, to calculate the probability to see coincidence, to see both detectors go click at the same time, I must add the probability amplitudes associated with those two processes. This process has an amplitude that's r squared, and this process has an amplitude t squared, where r and t were the transmission and reflection amplitudes that we talked about last time. And if this were 50-50 beam splitter, what we said that this was like 1 over root 2 squared, but this was I over root 2 squared. And because I squared is minus 1, these two cancel. They destructively interfere. Okay, and that is an example of non-classical interference in the context of light. This is a non-classical field, in a sense. These correlated photons that come out of this non-crystal, and we're going to study this in much more detail later in the semester, is an example of a non-classical light source, a source that can't be described by classical electromagnetism with some additional noise that's classical randomness on top of it. Okay. Yes, sir?
Where do we get that rule that we must add the probability amplitudes?
So that's a good question. We can say it's an axiom. Or we can say that it comes effectively from the Born rule. So let's remind ourselves about that for a moment quickly. Of course, yes. So in quantum mechanics, of course, generally, we describe the state of the system is described, say, by some ket in a Hilbert space. Okay? And let's suppose that this pet is written as a superposition of two other states, each one corresponding to a particular process or history. Okay? This state might correspond to both photons being reflected and this being both being transmitted. Okay. Now I can ask, what is the probability of seeing some eigenvalue associated with some observable? We know how to calculate that. The Born rule tells us to calculate the square of the probability amplitude, right? Of course, what that is the amplitude associated with this, and then there's a guy who's associated with that. All right? Now, that means that the square of this this is then alpha squared is under what circumstances do I see interference between these alternatives? The question has to do with, for this given final process, are these two histories, which correspond to say phi 1 and phi 2, are they orthogonal? If they're orthogonal, well then it may be the case that they have no common overlap with A, in which case I wouldn't see interference between these two cases. Or it might be that they both have equal amplitude, in which case they are at some level indistinguishable. So really the rule comes out of, there's nothing addition to quantum mechanics. It follows directly from it. But one thing to note is that it's not a hard and fast rule in the following sense. The degree to which these processes interfere is the degree to which they are, in principle, indistinguishable. If they are distinguishable in principle somehow, then they won't interfere. That's what comes out of the math. And it's what you would see in the following sense. Suppose I have this experiment, and really what comes out of these guys are two little photon wave packets. Okay? And those wave packets have some finite extent that depends on the details of the physics inside the crystal. Okay? And I didn't draw it, so well, I guess, you know, not the best, but let's say these wave packets are completely identical. Okay? Now suppose that what I can do, I have a little translation arm on my mirror here, and I can move this arm relative to the other, so that the two photons don't necessarily arrive at exactly the same time. But they have some finite overlap. Okay? What will I see on this coincidence counter as a function of time. Well, what I'll see is the following. So as a function of this sort of delta t over here, what I'll see is when delta t is zero, I see no coincidences. But as I start separating the two wave packets, I'll see start getting coincidences. And the degree to which I start seeing coincidences is the degree to which these guys are distinguishable. I can go from complete indistinguishability to partial indistinguishability, complete indistinguishability. It's a continuous thing, and that the same thing here that would follow directly from looking at math and how these overlaps go. And we would, this is what's known as the Hongo-Mandel dip. But there's no additional axioms we need to put into quantum mechanics to get this. We just need to follow the rules, and it comes out. We'll see this in much more detail. It'll unfold as we build the formalism a little bit more deeply. All right, so I guess there was one word that I put here that I never discussed, which is fluctuations. And unfortunately, I just erased something here, but we talked about how, well, we can obtain the same double slit interference pattern that one saw from the classical waves by looking at this photon by photon. But that's only in the limit of an infinite number of photons. For some, any finite number of photons, the pattern I'm going to see is not going to be exactly the classical interference pattern. It's going to have some noise, if you like, on top of it. Relative, I mean, if you had a single photon, this is going to be one click, right? It's not going to be anything like the interference pattern. You need many, 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 and eventually something about. So there's a notion in this that there's fluctuations, there's noise around the classical mean. And that fluctuations in this case, we could say, is quantum fluctuations. In the following sense, if I have a 50-50 beam splitter, if I send in a light field here, well then, half of it, if it's a classical wave, half of it comes out here, and half of the intensity comes out here. Always, right? Whereas if I put a single photon, well, I'm going to get a click here or a click here. If I collected a histogram of all the clicks, then in the limit of many, 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 many clicks, on average, I would see half of them here. But in any finite realization, there's fluctuations around that mean. And so there's something that's related to, in some sense, quantum noise, quantum fluctuations. The fact that the classical wave deterministically goes one way or another, whereas the quantum of light randomly has some kind of fluctuation, some kind of quantum noise, understanding the notion of quantum noise, is a central subject of quantum optics. And distinguishing it from what we're going to talk about today, in some sense, classical noise and classical fluctuations of light. Okay? So let's get into that a little bit. So what we talked about last lecture was a standard paradigm in thinking about it. Interference, the interferometer. Okay? And so we talked about the Mach-Zehnder interferometer. As an example of a two-path interferometer. So that involved having a beam splitter. Mirror. Another beam splitter. Okay. And we have two pads, L1 and L2. And there's some electric field in and some intensity, and there's some, say, out of this port, E out of that port, and some intensity, right? And what we showed last time is that these are 50-50 beam splitters, and this is if these are 50-50 beam splitters, then my intensity, my output intensity out of this port, which is the square of the complex amplitude up to some constant that we're not going to include, was equal to, and I think I got a factor of 2 screwed up in the last lecture, so if you know how to edit my video and put it back so in cyberspace it doesn't look, I don't look like an idiot forever, which I do lots of times. This is equal to what it's equal to is E in at T minus L1 over C squared. Plus E in squared plus E minus L1 over C star. If I wanted just to emphasize, this is output port 1, and there's an output port over here, too. So this is the intensity at output port 1. Then similarly, one at output port 2 has a minus sign here, and that's in sine squared omega delta L over C. Over C over 2. Sorry. So let me write it as K delta L. Or write it this way. Omega delta tau over 2. Omega delta tau over 2. Where delta tau is L2 minus L1. Oops. Right? so that's the time delay between two paths relative to the speed of light. Right, okay, and this, as a function of delta tau, which is just, of course, looks like this. And this goes on forever, no matter how big delta L is, forever and ever and ever and ever. Now that seems unlikely. I mean, this says that I get perfect constructive or deconstructive interference no matter how unbalanced the arms of this interferometer are. I can move this to the other side of the galaxy and just recombine them, and I'm going to get them to either perfectly interfere constructively or perfectly destructively interfere, no matter what, no matter how separated I am. Now that's, of course, an artifact of what I assumed about the input field. I assume this form, which is a wave train that goes on for perfect oscillation forever and a day, which of course is not a physical situation. It can go on pretty long, but it's never going to go on forever. Okay? So this field is perfect, this field which exhibits perfect coherence no matter what delta tau is an artifact of the fact that I assumed it to be so. Now, what would happen, for example, if you took the lovely light that bathes us here out of the fluorescent light bulbs in this room, or the sunshine that is sometimes the bane of our existence, but often we love in New Mexico, and instead of and shine that light, you know, I collimated it in a pinhole and then sent it into the interferometer. What do you expect in that case?
So attenuate?
What will attenuate?
The intensity.
The intensity as a function of what?
Of
delta tau?
Distance.
Yeah. I mean, as a function of my distance from the light, is that what you mean? The intensity is attenuating? I mean, that's true. There's a source. I mean, of course, you know, if I have a point source, the intensity falls off at some level as a function of distance. But if I, whatever intensity is put in here, you know, it's going to not attenuate going through this.
The light all has a random phase, right? So sometimes you interfere, sometimes you won't, but overall,
Right. So what is what? So what you said, Adrian, is correct, but in a slightly different way. Okay. What we kind of expect is that, well, this picture will somehow get attenuated. Come see why that is the case. We should end up seeing something like this. So that on average, when the distance between those mirrors is sufficiently unbalanced, what I get is half of the intensity going in one port and half to go in the other. There's no interference anymore. They're like they're two independent beams. One beam that, if there's no phase relationship between these two, well then half of it goes this way and half of it goes that way. So how would we model the light, say, that's coming out of the light bulbs? I mean, what's happening there? Well, you know, there's this current zooming around, knocking into the neon atoms, knocking them around, just like that, making them go chaotic. And that has some deleterious effects on the system. What can we say? Well, we can think about the atoms inside the neon atoms inside the fluorescent light bulb as, you know, radiators. They're oscillating charges that radiate. And they go up and down and radiate some field. Now, if you know, this emits some kind of spherical wave, and far enough away it looks like a plane wave. So if it were just oscillating in some interesting manner. However, so if I looked at, say, the electric field at this position as a function of time, it would go up and down, at the same frequency as this, right? However, if some other thing collides with it, it's going to disturb that oscillation. So all of a sudden, where it may have been the maximum, now it's down at a minimum. So if I were to look at the phase of this field, or what the field is doing as a function of time, I would see something that might look like this from a given single radiator of this sort. All of a sudden. So there's oscillation, but all of a sudden there's a collision, which I'm assuming to be essentially instantaneous, which disturbs the phase and resets it in some random way. So there's a random phase kick given to the field. And moreover, when those kicks happen is also random, depending on the density and pressure of the gas in the light bulb or inside the sun. And to tell me some kind of kinetic theory about this. Okay. So for a given atom, I could say the electric field for a given atom, we call it the ith atom, as a function of time, has some amplitude, say, it has some base oscillation frequency, which is related to whatever the resonance is that's binding the charge. And then it would have a random phase. And this is a classically stochastic variable. It's, or at least we can model it as such. We can think about it as, well, you know, there's just all this Avogadro's number of junk going on, and we just don't have enough information to keep track of it. If we could, we'd know exactly what to expect, and we'd have some complicated many-body system of Avogadro number of particles to keep track of. But because we can't do that, we just say, well, if there's a random phase with some kinetic theory that we might do for homework that tells us something about what that phase is. I mean, you know, gosh, we're going to do thermodynamics. If he likes it, he'll be really good sometimes. All right, so with that, we can think about, well, what is the field that we have? Well, we have an Avogadro's number of these things, or some large ensemble. So the total electric field that I see is the superposition of all of these electric fields. Okay. So the total electric field here is a sum of many, many such things, but with all different random realizations of the phase kicks that are sampled from the appropriate probability distribution that's associated with the physics that happens. Okay? So my total electric field then will be, you know, the sum of all these guys for, say, n atoms. Right? Which is E0 times the sum over I e minus I omega t, sum over I e to the I phi sub I of t, my rounded phase. Okay. Now, for homework, we're going to study this in a little more detail to try to understand what is the intensity associated with this field that's coming from this collection of atoms. Yeah.
Is there a physical reason why we wouldn't want a T after the phi I of T, which is why it would not change the frequency but just the phase?
We could do that, but they could be lumped together, right? I mean, so physically, what we're assuming here is the following thing. We're imagining there is a binding energy of the electron to the nucleus or whatever molecule. And that has a definite frequency, a resonance frequency. Now, so if I just imagine, you know, here's my slinky. You see it? There's my slinky. And then I just kick it. It's going to change the phase, but the frequency, after I stop being, the frequency is the same related to the resonance frequency. Right? I can think about that little phase as, well, there was over some time, it was slightly changed frequency, and then phi would be some delta omega times t. I can certainly do that. But it's not, it won't add anything new to this model. All right, so with that said, let's look at what we expect from our interferometer based on that. Well, now my intensity output is not, I really need to say that I have to average this over the probability distribution, because I don't know what it is. It's the expected value, right? So this is the average value, averaged over the random variable that describes the random phases. This is a classical average I'm doing. All right. So, now what? Well, so each one of these guys here, well, that is equal to, that firstly we could say the following thing. Let's write down the following. Let's look at the correlation function, as it's sometimes called. Based on that model, that's E0 squared, the e to the minus I omega TA, or TB minus TA, the average value sum over I. And J. to the I T A minus T B T J B. Right? That's just multiplying that out. Okay. Now, the first thing we can do is make some assumptions about the physics. Well, before I do that, let's look at the following case. When TA equals TB, so this cancels, let's look at each. Sorry. There's two different things I want to say. I'm trying to think about the right order when you say them. It doesn't really matter here. Let me say this other thing first. Let's say J equals TB. Okay? So then this equals E0 squared times when I equals J N plus I not equal J E0 squared the expected value of terms that correspond to the same oscillator and the terms that correspond to different oscillators. If this is a random variable drawn from some random distribution, the two, assuming that there's no correlation between different oscillators, then on average, each oscillator is going to have a random phase respect to the other at the same time. So this is zero. This is just to say, if I have a collection of oscillators that are oscillating with random phases one another, there's no interference between those different oscillators. And the total intensity in that case is just n times, instead of n squared. You add the intensities. There is no interference. Okay. What about when TA doesn't equal TB? Well, so let's look again when TA doesn't equal TB. I can do the same thing. I can break this up into the two cases. The cases where they're different oscillators, again, it doesn't matter. This is zero. But for the same oscillator, I have to be careful. Because over some time scale, the thing that I just erased, can you see that? Over some time scale, in between collisions, it had some coherence. It's just when a collision happened, then all of a sudden it jumped. So for the same oscillator within some time, there is some memory of its oscillation. Then it got knocked out of the head, lost its memory, and went, but in between it kind of remembers. It has some finite time scale which it knows what its oscillation is. So let's write that down. So when TA doesn't equal TB, this equals E0 squared minus I omega TA minus TB times the sum I not equal to J, the times, I mean, where it's only one sum, where they're not equal, that doesn't matter. You said that's zero. I A minus B. Okay? Now, one thing we could say is that what the phase difference here is only depends on, statistically, on the difference in time. It doesn't depend on the origin of time. That is to say that the statistics are unchanging with time. The temperature of this gas is unchanging with time. The pressure of the gas. Under that assumption, the rate of collisions and the statistics and the random probability distribution itself is constant. That's called stationary statistics. In that case, this is equivalent to saying this is the average of e to the I ta minus tb minus this at zero. Yes, Vivek.
Two questions.
Yep.
First, what is ta and tb, and where did the j go in that term?
So ta and tb are just two arbitrary times. Okay, I'm just choosing a two-time correlation function. And what I argued here, as we did for this case, that I can break up the sum over two cases, where j equals I, and then when the case where j doesn't, where I and j are not the same, then the two oscillators have no correlation with one another, and it goes to zero.
So you're using the same argument
there? Same argument there. And now I'm using a slightly enriched argument, which also applies there, it didn't matter, that I have stationary statistic. Now, what we imagine to be true is that if this time difference is big compared to the time between collisions, then these guys are uncorrelated, and this should be zero. If the time is zero, well, that's, then we would see a correlation because it's the same phase. And as long as that time is short compared to the time scale between collisions, then we expect some memory of the phase, right? And again, a kinetic theory will show us that this is equal to e to the minus ta minus tb over tau naught, where tau naught is the time between collisions. Now there can be an overall phase here. I really should have some phase, because this is a complex number. This is really just the magnitude of this thing goes like this, because the collisions can actually phase, on average, phase shift everything, but I'm just saying it doesn't matter. It doesn't make an argument. I'm just going to ignore that for the moment. All right, so now let's look at what that means over here. Well, so this is equal to, this is the case where TA equals TB. So this is, I can rewrite this whole thing once again, as 1/4 I in, plus if this is again the same thing, I in, correlating itself. And then this is plus the expected value of E star 0 plus E
zero the tau, where tau equals L1 minus L2 over 2. Okay, the time delay between the two arms of the interferometer. And I use the case of stationary statistics, that this correlation function depends not just on TA and TB, but the time diff, only the time difference between them. That's what I did. Okay? So this can be rewritten as 1 half IN plus twice the real part of the expected value of this. So this is an example of a 2-time correlation function. I'm correlating the field with itself at two different times. And the way that I do that is with an interferometer. So I have a little translation stage here. I can move this mirror with respect to it, and then divide the field in half and correlate it with itself at two different times, sometimes known as an autocorrelation, because I'm correlating it with itself. Okay? And by displacing the field relative to what I'm seeing, how far can I displace the field from itself before it loses coherence, before it loses phase memory of what it was? Okay? So let's plug in what we have for this. In this case, this was equal to n e0 squared. So we had, this was the intensity from a single radiator. We just have n of them because they're all independent. And this. Whereas this, if I was equal to n e0 squared e to the I omega delta tau times e to the minus delta tau over g0. Those are, that was my 2-time correlation function. This was what we got from this erase thing right over here. Right? It was called T erase TB. All right. So that then is equal to n e0 squared over 2 times 1 plus oh no, there's a fourth, so this is just, there's no 2 here, right? Because there are 2 of them, twice the real part gives me 2 times it to the half factors out. Yep. So this becomes cosine omega delta t e to the minus delta t over tau naught. All right, let's sketch that. So this is my output intensity of that 4-degree farmer. So it's this guy. What comes out over here? Yes, sir.
We missed a square. Any
E naught squared, yes. Indeed. Thanks. All right. Let's sketch that. What does it look like? It's exactly what we said. Some kind of attenuation. So if I plot that as a function of delta t,
density.
Well, when delta T is big compared to tau naught, it's just half of this, right? So here's asymptotically, it looks flat at just half the intensity going here. Okay. At times short, delta T short compared to T naught, this is 1. And then I would either get, it would interfere or not in positive or negative direction. And so what I would see is something that looks like this. Is that depending on how big tau naught is compared to the period of oscillation, will determine sort of how many fringes I can see. Where delta T here, of course, depends on L1 minus L2 over C. And what we would say is there's some kind of, I mean, it's supposed to be exponential in a Gaussian. Boy, sorry. That there's a kind of characteristic scale here which we might call the coherence time when this falls off by 1 over E, which is tau naught, or a coherence length. That is to say, how imbalanced can I make these two arms of my interferometer before basically the waves have lost phase memory from one another? Because it's that phase memory that is what interference allows interference to happen. Okay? And that phase memory is lost on a time scale that's long compared to the collision time. It is the collision time that is determining the coherence time. Yeah?
Is the length of the C times T naught?
Yeah, it should be. The coherence length here, yeah, is indeed. That's right.
So if they're short time.
If the time between collisions is very short, then the coherence length is very short.
So going like does have coherence, just usually
it's tiny.
Yeah.
So what people sometimes talk about is a white light interferometer. Ever heard that term before? Some of you might have heard of that. A white light interferometer, if the distance, if it's perfectly balanced, it doesn't matter. We're going to get perfect right at zero. I'm going to get all of this, all of the light out here, and none of it out there. Of course, the tiniest movement, depending on the coherence length, is you mean I wouldn't see interference anymore. And of course, a laser has a much longer coherence length. It's not infinite, but it's not much, much longer than the coherence length. Now what we would call this kind of light is not perfectly coherent. It's partially coherent to the degree that tau naught is finite. If tau naught gets very, 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 very small, then we effectively call this just perfect, just incoherent light with just random phase altogether.
So
So my person morally with their lamps and their mirrors had to have had that thing so
they had a lot
of exactly. The parents' lamp.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's impressive.
Yeah. Pretty impressive. Right. One way we can talk about the coherence here is the visibility of the fringes. So the fringe visibility is, you know, if I'm looking at this, there's not a big difference between bright and dark. It's not very visible. I can't tell the difference. Right out here, bright and dark look almost the same. They're kind of, they're not visible. Whereas there's a big visibility here. So one talks about the visibility of the fringes, which is the maximum intensity minus the minimum intensity normalized to the sum of the two.
Okay.
So in this case, I max is when the cosine is 1. So that's equal to I n times 1. Half 1 plus e to the minus, and the minimum intensity is with the minus sign. Okay, and so this, I'm sorry, it should be plus, otherwise this is whatever. And so this is equal to just that envelope function. The visibility function is just this correlation. So one of the lessons to take away from what we see here is that one way to measure coherence is to measure a correlation function. In particular, this is what we call temporal coherence. How different is the field at different points in time? We could also talk about spatial coherence as well. How what's the phase relation between at the same time different points in space? And we measured that coherence here by this interferometer, which enabled us to do that correlation by autocorrelating the field with itself. Okay. And we see these kinds of correlation functions a lot. Okay. I want to shift gears a little bit just to get started on where we're headed from here. So, as I discussed at the very beginning, our studies in quantum optics are not just about the coherence properties of the light itself, but also about the coherence induced in matter by light. Okay? What do I mean by that? Well, we already kind of sort of saw of just a little bit of that in the discussion lecture today. Where we were talking about a Lorentz oscillator and whether this oscillator had a definite coherent oscillation with a well-defined phase, or it was incoherent because, for example, there were collisions associated with the environment. But what I said was that coherence had something to do with interference, right? And what does coherence, what about quantum coherence in matter? Well, when we talk about the quantum description, typically we think about energy levels, right? We think about, oh, you know, there's an atom, it has a ground state, it has a first excited state, etc. And I can have quantum superpositions of grounds and excited states, which might correspond to different processes. In fact, there is, and what we're going to talk about in the next lectures is about the relationship between these guys, between the description of the atom as a bound electron oscillating, and this picture, which seems to have nothing whatsoever to do with this picture. In fact, you should think about this completely like this, as we shall see. And part of the question is, when can't you think about it like this? When is this classical picture of a classical oscillator not the right picture? Here's an example. Suppose my atom had some kind of degeneracy. What do I mean? So let's suppose I have an atom that looks like this. Suppose its ground state had three sublevels. They might be the Zeeman sublevels of an atom that has a total angular momentum 1. And you know that there are magnetic sublevels, m equals 1, 0, and minus 1, right? So let's say that this was m equals minus 1, m equals 0, and m equals plus 1. And suppose there's some excited state up here, and suppose it's, I'm going to just give them better labels, call it g minus 1, g 0, and g plus 1. Okay. Now suppose I were to shine light on this atom, but suppose that light could simultaneously drive the system from this state to this state at the same time that it can drive the state from that state to that state. Now, you may remember, if you've studied it, there's something called selection rules for absorption and emission. And if this is an m equals zero state, this is a loud transition. This would correspond to absorbing 1 unit angular momentum. We call that sigma plus. This is a removing 1 unit along the atom's direction. We call this sigma minus. So if I send in linearly polarized light, which is a superposition of sigma plus and sigma minus, it will drive this case. Now, it turns out that depending on nature of atom, it might be that there the amplitude for this completely destructively interferes with that. That is to say, if the atom is in a superposition of this state and this state, it will not absorb light. It is transparent. And that's a phenomenon that's known as EIG, or electromagnetic induced transparency. This kind of atom cannot be thought about like this. Somehow the two possible Lorentz oscillators are quantumly interfering with one another. There are two processes, the process by which it absorbs this kind of light and the process by which it absorbs this kind of light, which are indistinguishable. I can't tell. And because of that, I have to add their amplitudes, and it turns out in certain cases, those amplitudes will destructively interfere. This is an example of quantum coherence in matter. This would not be the case if these two atoms were not in coherent superposition with one another. If there was not a good phase relationship in the wave function between these two, then, well, I could tell it went that way or it went that way. But the fact that it's in superposition allows, and how I create that, well, again, it's through the interaction with the light itself. So what we're going to study, because it's the first thing to study that is the clearest and simplest, because dealing with the field itself is challenging, because first we got to do quantum field theory. We got to talk about the quantum theory of the electric field if we're going to talk about true quantum coherence in the electromagnetic field. We have to first quantize the field. So before we get there, what we're going to do is talk about important notions of quantum coherence in the context of matter. So just to conclude, let me flash one thing up here on the board. Let me set this up first. Our global Wi-Fi is on. All right, good. Can you give me the lights, please? So, on our webpage is this ancient map, which I made, 15, 20 years ago. And I can't find the original file, but this little one had this up for me. Which gives you a little bit of a roadmap of the subject matter. Because as I say, there are two main streams of the subject. One stream, I would say, has to do with optical coherence. This is what you might say is the core of the subject, what most people would call quantum optics. Which, as you suggested, it goes all the way back to, Michelson and Morley, and moves through. We're going to actually, Roy Glauber, who is one of the founders of the subject, he's a Nobel Prize winner for quantum optics in 2005, is going to be here to deliver the quote. He's, I think, Roy turned 91. He's my hero, and he's delightful to hear, and I encourage you to see that. So we're going to be spending some time, but there's another part of the subject which is equally important, which has to do with the kind of thing that we were just mentioning, what I would call quantum coherent spectroscopy, the ways in which one probes and manipulates matter with light in a way in which the quantum interference within the matter matters, okay? That it's not just quantum jumps and absorption and this, that, but something having to do with quantum superpositions within. And that goes back to Stern-Grillo, right? And everything are we able to manipulate things like the spins within atoms that led, Stern-Grillo, direct descendants of them, Robbie, Ramsey, Towns, these guys, the development of the lasers. You see, the laser plays a central role. So in some sense, it was the laser that unified together what was going on, what you might say, in the microwave domain or the RF domain of spins with, instead, electronics states where you manipulate absorption of light. We would now think about that. What the properties of the lasers that are themselves were, how are they non-classical, and how did the laser enable us to manipulate atoms? And then the spine down the middle here is the foundations of quantum mechanics. I would say that most of us who have gotten into this field to study it have gotten into it because we have always been fascinated and interested in questions, the foundations of quantum mechanics. And of course, you know, goes back to the beginning, what is a photon, and how would we understand the interference, but to more modern questions relating to entanglement and Bell's inequalities, and more recently, quantum information. I would say that no subdiscipline within physics takes quantum mechanics as seriously as quantum opticians. Not the condensed matter physicists, not the particle theory, you know. They wouldn't know a density matrix if they saw it. See, I said. We will. So we're going to be both learning about the foundation of quantum mechanics and how these different areas allowed us to explore the foundation of quantum mechanics. And those foundations of quantum mechanics also inform how we think about manipulating light and atoms as well. So that's what we intend to do for this semester. All right? All right, folks. So we will have a discussion section tomorrow. See you then.
What room is that going to be in?
What's that?
What room?